This is Stephanie Huff, and we are continuing with the concept of metabolism. In this lecture, we are going to talk about diabetes in children. Just an overview, diabetes mellitus is a disorder of metabolism. It results in hyperglycemia due to a defect in insulin secretion, insulin action, or both. Type 1 diabetes is the leading cause of diabetes in children younger than 10. Type 2 diabetes usually occurs ages 10 to 19. It's also, there is a MODY, it's M-O-D-Y. It is a maturity onset of diabetes in youth. And NDM, which is neonatal diabetes mellitus. Both of those are rare. Only 1% to 5% of all cases of diabetics in young individuals are diagnosed with either one of these types of diabetes. Type 1 diabetes in children, it is an autoimmune disorder, disease that results from the immune system's failure to recognize itself. It results in normal host tissues being targeted by the immune defenses. Risk factors is a combination of genetic and environmental factors. The one proven environmental trigger of type 1 diabetes is congenital rubella. Other risk factors are race, ethnicity, and family history. Clinical manifestations are going to be hyperglycemia. They will have increased thirst, hunger, and urination, fatigue, and blurred vision. These manifestations of type 1 usually appear as an acute event that requires emergency intervention. They may actually present in DKA. Weight loss is another symptom of type 1 diabetes in children. Therapy is aimed at correcting metabolic acidosis, restoring fluid and electrolyte imbalance, and achieving euglycemia, which is normal concentration of glucose in the blood. Collaboration, take a team of caretakers, the primary care provider, dietitian, certified diabetes instructor, school nurse, may also include a social worker or a psychologist. Any school or daycare that is open to the public must provide special needs of a child with diabetes by providing a written individualized education plan. There are federal laws that protect children. This includes the Rehabilitation Act of 1973, Individuals with Disabilities Education Act of 1990. It was reauthorized in 2004, and the Americans with Disabilities Act of 1990. Children must be allowed to participate in sports and extracurricular activities that are available at schools and daycares. Looking at diagnostic tests, confirming the presence of diabetes, this can be done through a hemoglobin A1C level of 6.5 or higher in combination with a random blood glucose, random blood plasma glucose level of 200 milligrams per deciliter or higher, or a fasting plasma glucose of 126 milligrams per deciliter or higher. All right, glucose monitoring. Children require more frequent monitoring than adults, and they have different targets due to erratic oral intake activity. All right, insulin is a lifelong requirement in type 1 diabetes. Daily insulin dosage depends on many factors, including age, weight, stage of puberty, duration and phase of the diabetes, state of the injection sites, their nutritional intake and distribution, exercise patterns and their daily routine, results of glucose monitoring and comorbid illnesses. Continuous sub-Q insulin infusions have become more popular with young individuals. They have what's a correction factor. The additional amount of insulin needed to be given with meals based on the child's pre-meal blood glucose level in order to reach the post-meal glucose target level. The child and parent will learn how to adjust the amount of rapid insulin necessary to cover the carbohydrate intake and at a meal. The insulin to carbohydrate ratio may differ according to the meal and the activity level of the child as well. But I know they do a lot of carb counting with kids, and so they basically know how much insulin to give themselves according to how much carbs they eat, and as well as based on their blood sugar levels. Nutrition therapy is based on healthy eating guidelines. They are age specific. And that is because infants and toddlers, school-aged children, adolescents, that is based on the insulin, the type of food they eat, as well as their weight. And there is a table on page 771 in your book, and it's 12-8 that goes into a lot more detail on those nutrition guidelines. Right, managing complications, many are going to be the same as adults. Some are more prevalent in children. Celiac disease, they cannot hydrolyze peptides that contain gluten. This occurs with increased frequency in kids with type 1 diabetes. It is also called tropical sprue. Thyroid disease is an autoimmune disorder, usually hypothyroidism, but can less commonly be caused by hyperthyroidism. Eating disorders for type 1 and type 2, when hyperglycemia occurs, calories are lost and weight loss occurs. Therefore, diabetes is unique in that body weight and shape can be altered by stopping insulin. And there's 12 to 15% of adolescents that will omit insulin for weight control. Hypoglycemia is frequent and severe if can be severe with severe complications that can occur. Kids are at increased risk for hypoglycemia. More so than adults due to their erratic nutritional intake, their increase in activity levels, and their growth spurts. Alcohol use with oral agents or insulin can result in profound hypoglycemia. You really worry about that in your adolescence. Long-term complications are the same as those in adult diabetics. All right, looking at complementary and alternative therapy, regardless of the type of diabetes, the cornerstone for management in children includes diet, exercise, medications, whether that be oral agents or insulin, glucose monitoring, more prevalent therapies are dietary supplements. Many use these in the morning to enhance their diabetic management. This could be alpha lipoic acid, chromium, omega-3 fatty acids, garlic, magnesium, coenzyme, Q10, ginseng, some of your botanical therapy is prickly pear cactus, aloe vera, bitter melon. The most widely used CAM, which is complementary and alternative therapy, is cinnamon. It's also used in Chinese medicine and has shown to affect blood glucose and insulin signaling. All right, diabetes type 2 in children is increasing because of the rise in obesity and inactivity in today's youth. As in adults or with type 2, there is an insulin resistance that leads to pancreatic fatigue as the organ tries to keep up with insulin production. And this results in hyperglycemia. Most common in certain ethnic groups, your Hispanic boys and non-Hispanic black girls both are affected by obesity. Your risk factors for type 2 diabetics in kids. That's going to be similar to adults. Gender, usually female, being overweight, family member with the disorder, being a member of a high-risk ethnic group, showing signs of insulin resistance, being ages 10 to 19, and experiencing puberty are all risk factors. Clinical manifestations are less acute than in type 1 diabetics. They can range of symptoms related to hyperglycemia. It may include weight gain, overweight, their BMI greater than the 85th percentile for age, sex, weight, and height. Insulin resistance, typically they have these skin changes known as acanthosis nigricans, and the skin is velvety in texture. It's a sort of a brownish and black in color with hyperkeratotic plaques. It's usually found on the neck, thigh, axilla, and knuckles. And so here are some examples of that and what they look like. All right, collaboration for type 2 diabetics and children, careful communication among all adults caring for the child in any situation. Need to address nutrition and exercise. This is going to be important treatment and management in type 2 diabetes. Hypoglycemic agents are not the first line treatment for kids with type 2 diabetics. Instead, they focus on decreasing insulin sensitivity with advancing sexual maturity, physical growth, and the ability to provide self-management. Diet and exercise is effective in less than 10% of kids with type 2 diabetes. An oral medication is usually required. Metformin, also known as glucophage, has been approved for use in kids as an adjunct to diet and exercise. Metabolic needs, metformin needs at least 4 weeks to take effect, so a lot of them will use insulin for a short time while they're waiting for the metformin to kick in. All right, continue with collaboration. Managing complications, most diabetic training, education materials designed for children, adolescents with type 1 diabetes. So they emphasize on insulin glucose monitoring. So this may not be appropriate for your kids with type 2 diabetes. The American Academy of Pediatrics presents recommendations for complications of hypertension, dyslipidemia, retinopathy, microalbuminemia in the urine, and depression. Looking at the nursing process, requires assessing the physiological, psychosocial, environmental, and developmental needs of the child. At diagnosis, you want to establish a baseline. So they're looking at hemoglobin A1C, lipid profile, eye exam, initiate diabetic education, establishing goals for them, evaluating microalbuminuria, refer to nutrition and behavioral therapy as needed. Quarterly, they will assess injection sites, self-management skills, dietary needs, and physical activity levels. They will discuss tobacco and alcohol, as well as drug use. They will measure their hemoglobin A1C levels, as well as their fasting glucose levels. Annually, they will be given flu vaccines. They will have a physical assessment, a foot assessment. They will refer them for an annual eye exam, and they will evaluate them for microalbuminuria. All right, assessment. Children with type 1 diabetes are seen first in the hospital because they need immediate treatment. Their presenting symptoms and pathology involved requires emergency and critical care interventions. Usually they present in DKA, box 12-7 on page 776 discusses this. They will continually assess their vital signs, respiratory status, and blood sugar. They will need cardiac monitoring required because there's a potential for hypokalemia. Intake and output is recorded every hour. IV fluid boluses, they will do 10 to 20 milliliters per kilogram if hypovolemic. Insulin infusions are titrated to bring the blood sugar down slowly. Too rapidly decrease in blood sugar causes cerebral complications and neurologic changes. Once acidosis is corrected and blood sugar is improved, insulin drip is tapered off and subcutaneous insulin is started. Food will be introduced when the child is alert and blood glucose levels have stabilized. So once the child has stabilized, education will be started, and they will look at survival skills for discharge, family stress and coping, as well as follow-up plans. All right, so in their assessment, they should have the ability to administer insulin, identify and treat hypoglycemia, monitor their blood sugars, provide a diet appropriate to the diagnosis. These are your NANDA diagnoses that are found in your kids with diabetes. Planning depends on assessment findings in the acute phase. For your newly diagnosed diabetics with type 1, the focus is going to be related to the complex pathophysiologic alterations, such as electrolyte imbalances, fluid deficits, fatigue, and pain. The discharge planning should start at the time of diagnosis and move forward to prepare the child for self-management of glucose monitoring and administration of insulin and or medications. And signs and symptoms of hypoglycemia and actions to take. Links to community resources. There are several available out there. Family involvement in the planning is going to be crucial for the success of management and treatment of the children with diabetes. Looking at implementation, you want to assess barriers to implementing discharge planning as teaching proceeds. This is all continuously being done. Topics to cover prior to discharge will include their diet, medication, exercise, glucose monitoring, and prevention, recognition, and interventions for those acute complications. And this is just showing them how regular exercise can help keep their blood sugar levels under control. All right, an evaluation. The child and the parent both need to be present at the interview. Skills assessed by having the child or parent demonstrate how to deliver insulin and or oral medications. You want to ask how many times a week do you miss your insulin or medication to gain an accurate information is going to be helpful in this process. You also want to make sure that you're asking open-ended questions such as tell me about the food you're eating to encourage the child to share their likes and dislikes. It also gives the nurse an idea of the child's daily intake of their food. You also want to try to elicit a 24-hour food recall to gain specific information from the child who is not keeping a food log. You want to address the knowledge on actions to take in case of hypoglycemia. So you want to obtain frequency of hypoglycemic episodes that they may have, review a logbook or a glucose meter for trending of their glucose control. Early expectations post-discharge should be realistic. Support should be given to a both the child and the parent as well. So this is the end of the lecture for diabetes in children, and a lot of the stuff is similar that it was for adults. But if you have any questions, please let me know and I will try to help clarify things.